Hey, Terrence, how are you today?
I'm doing very well, thanks. How about you?
I'm doing good. Thanks so much for taking time out to talk with us today.
Oh, hey, no problem.
Well, we're talking about your latest movie, The Last Heist, which hit theaters, video on demand, and iTunes this coming Friday, June 17th. Can you tell us a little about the movie?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's kind of a fun little movie. Basic premise, I suppose, is bank robbers meet serial killer. You know, it doesn't take itself too seriously, but it's a good time.
Well, I'll tell you, one of the aspects I really liked about the movie was its setting. Much like Reservoir Dogs, the entire movie takes place inside this building where the characters are holed up. And what happens many times is when a film has one location, it can get boring very quickly. But I have to hand it to the filmmakers here because they kept it interesting the whole way through. Was this an element that attracted you to the script?
Well, I'll tell you what, one of the things that I enjoyed when we were shooting it, and because it was all in one room, and we didn't have a lot of time to make it, frankly. So there was an element where we'd only get maybe one or two takes of a scene, whereas like I'm used to working in television with a larger budget, which you end up having almost too much time sometimes to do things, too much time to write, too much time to think. This just kept us really, really on our toes and really active, and there was a lot of room for improvisation, not only of dialogue, but of movement. So there was something very freeing about not having to hit a specific mark and being able to kind of tear around a room, and they'd just light this whole thing, and the camera would follow us where we needed to go, because
right.
We didn't have time to turn around a lot of the time. Like, you just kind of had to get this. So a lot of the movie's handheld, and it gives it this kind of pacing. So even though you're in this generally one setting, I think there's a lot of movement to it and a lot of interest.
Well, yeah, I agree with that. And your character is the leader of a band of thieves who plan on stealing over $100 million from the drug cartel, but things don't go according to plan. And as well as the cops unexpectedly arriving, they quickly discover that there's a serial killer in the building along with them. And that's not exactly the kind of story you expect from a movie like this. Was that angle something that you were able to appreciate?
Yeah, absolutely, because usually you've got a heist movie or you've got a serial killer movie. And this sort of explores what happens when you mash them together.
Right.
It's a movie where everybody's got their own angle. There's not a lot of good guys in it. Also, there's a lot of shades of gray, frenetic. And I don't think you really know who's going to come out on top of it or what anybody's motivations are. And I just think it's interesting. Like, it's not a blow you away big budget action thriller. It's got something, you know, it has to rely on other things for its storytelling, which I found interesting.
Right, right. Well, as the story progresses, we see the group slowly start to buckle under the pressure, and you see this in a lot of heist movies. They start fighting with each other. With the cops outside and the serial killer inside, a special task force turn up ready to kick ass, so the movie keeps throwing curveballs at you and kind of takes you off guard. And I love the fact that the story kept laying twist after twist on the audience right up until the very end. I really appreciated that.
Yeah, that's fun as a character, too, you know? Like, the most fun stuff to play is when you got the squeeze put on you, and, you know, how does this guy act under pressure? You know, and I think maybe that's how he became the leader of these guys, is he's a pretty, you know, he keeps his cool under pressure. He maintains his ability to think, but then this tests his limits with that, and it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, I noticed that about your character. Like he was, like you said, he was very laid back, very relaxed, where everybody else was freaking out. Now, in the movie, you guys handled what appeared to be some very serious weaponry. Did you have to receive any sort of training for that?
Thankfully, the ones that we were using, like, we didn't have the money for squibs or for blanks or anything like that. So we were actually just kind of shooting airsoft versions.
Oh, okay.
And then they were able to work a little bit of magic in post for us. And some of the blood splatter that you see is actually, there were these sort of like, basically rather than little exploding packets, we'd have hoses rigged up through our clothing. Like, they came up with this ingenious sort of thing that would just kind of shoot blood. They had a hydraulic, something that just had a huge amount of air pressure, and then they would kind of load the hose up with blood, and then at the moment of the shot, they'd just kind of let her rip, and the blood would just go and go shooting out. So it ended up with this cool, like, squib-like effect.
Right.
The trick is, the other thing is, we only had, like, maybe one or two white shirts each. You know, like,
when you're working with a budget like that, it's pretty funny. Like, so you're like, okay, we have to really pick and choose our moments to get bloody here. And so
right.
you kind of maybe would only get one, again, you'd get like one or two chances at it at most. So it really, like, the stakes of every take, it was a really exhilarating process and a little less meticulous than I'm used to and a little more flying by the seat of your pants.
Now, Henry Rollins is known for playing very serious and intimidating characters. And in The Last Heist, he gets to play the most intimidating of them all, a serial killer. How did you guys get on during filming?
Yes. We only overlapped by a couple days. We actually don't have any scenes together in the film. So there was a couple days where we were both shooting on the same day, but we never actually technically worked together. So the extent of my interaction with him was just sort of hanging out with him at lunch over the course of a couple days. And he's a really
right.
interesting guy. I guess he would be intimidating if he weren't just so nice.
Yeah.
Like just he's a kind guy. He was generous, and he was just above all an excellent storyteller. So
right.
when he's talking, everybody just kind of sits and listens.
Right.
Very interesting guy. I've admired him for a long time, so it was a very cool thing to get to meet him. And even though I didn't technically work with him, I kind of did, you know.
Yeah.
We appear in the credits together, so I can kind of say I did.
Right. Well, you've played a lot of various characters throughout your career, including good guys and bad guys. And as an indie filmmaker myself, I think it's vital for any performer to be very open-minded, because you have a lot of actors out there who only play good guys or only play bad guys. And I think with that kind of thinking, I don't think they realize they're hurting themselves and limiting their acting potential. What is it you look for when you're handed a script?
It depends on the context. So sometimes I'm just happy for a job because I need the money and I haven't worked in a while.
Right.
Sometimes, like in the case of something like The Last Heist, I'd had a steady job working on Rain for a couple years. And
yeah.
you really only have about a month window where you can do something. So the number of projects you can do in that time are very limited. Because of the time, you're limited to sort of a one-off little guest star on something or a low-budget film which shoots in 2 to 3 weeks, because you don't have time for the big-budget sort of six-month ordeal. And in that context, a lot of the low-budget movies that are available are things like Lifetime and Hallmark movies, which tend to be, for lack of a better word, just like in sort of a similar wheelhouse to the energy on Rain. And not that they're period dramas or anything, but it's this sort of, there's a gentle sort of romantic energy to things.
Yeah.
And so when this came along, it was an opportunity to do something that was just, you know, a dick flick, really. Like, truly,
yeah.
like, everybody's just pure testosterone in this, you know? Like, men, women, children, you know, it doesn't really matter. Everybody's just really got a lot of balls, I think. And
right.
it was an intimidating energy to walk into, and it really jolted me awake and made me realize how easy I've had it the last few years.
Right.
It was a lot of fun. You know, I'm just surrounded by guys twice my size.
Well, you've been acting for many years, both in TV and in film, and there's a lot of actors that start out like that and eventually turn to directing. Do you think that's something you'd like to try your hand at someday?
Oh, I don't know. I'm not sure if I'm a director or not. You know, I have ideas, and I like to contribute ideas. Like, I think I can work with actors, and then I just kind of see how huge the whole production of it is and
yeah.
all the pre-production, and then I see, you know, I've seen actors turn directors who then, and I see them learning, and I see them kind of like go, oh, wow, maybe someday. I don't think I'm quite there yet, but maybe I'll fall into it somewhere along the way.
Right, right. Okay, one last question for you then. You have a new TV series called Still Star-Cross, which is currently filming. Can you tell me anything about that?
So far we've shot a pilot. And we were very lucky. We got picked up while we were still shooting the pilot, which
cool.
doesn't happen too often. But they were so happy with the raw footage coming out that they're like, yeah, keep making it. So we start making that in August. I just met, they've just assembled the team of writers that's going to write it. And I met them all last night, actually. Everybody's really nice. We're all really excited to get going on it. And, yeah, we're making, I think, 8 more episodes of that in addition to the pilots to round out season one. So that and I imagine that'll come out in the new year sometime. It's a Romeo and Juliet spinoff.
Oh, very nice.
So anybody who is a fan of Rain, I think, is really going to get on board with this, but I think some people that maybe didn't find Rain quite to their taste will find something to like in this.
Right.
I don't know. It's another period drama, but this one's in Italy instead of France. I don't know. It's a different sort of story, but it's got a lot of heart to it, a lot of great characters. The scope of it is huge. It's got to be one of the more expensive things I've worked on in terms of just the locations and the shots that we're getting, the
right.
trains and the drones and the there's a lot of location porn, as we call it. I mean, aside from that, there's some good content in there as well. But it also it's one of these things that's just a treat to look at. You feel like you're a part of something big when you've got 1,000 extras in a big sword fight and this huge crane flying over your head. And you're in Spain. Like, you know, it's got an epic feel to it. There's the small little human story within it as well. But I think the scope of the world is going to impress people.
Well, that sounds like something I'd really like to see as well.
Yeah, it's cool. I guess I guess in Spain, your money goes a long way. Just what they can pull together there and just the depth of experience of all the people that they pulled from around Europe to work on the thing is very cool.
Well, folks, today I was speaking with Torrence Coombs. He is the star of the upcoming action thriller, The Last Heist, which hits theaters, video on demand, and iTunes this coming Friday, June 17th from Accelerator Media. Torrence, thanks so much for your time. Good luck with the movie and good luck with the new show.
Thank you so much. I appreciate your time.